So it's a pleasure to be here. And I'm thanking the organizers for inviting me and giving me a chance to speak to you about what Franciscans have to say about faith and science. You already heard a Jesuit this morning, Father Spitzer. You heard a Dominican if you went to Father Ramelow's talk. And today, the Franciscan view of nature. And what I find significant about the Franciscan tradition is really that we address what is at the very heart of the faith and science conflict, which is the human person. Do we really have trust? Do we have trust in our own reality as a paradigm of individual being and also as being in community? For Franciscan friars, community life is a very important part of our formation, our spirituality, our way of making sense of the world. So do we really trust in the knowledge of human nature that we learn from our own nature, our own being, our community? And can we use that to provide context for science as opposed to trying to make human nature fit into science? And very important is the very specific way that Francis, Saint Francis, understood fraternity, fraternity with all creatures, the canticle of creation. This is really the specifically Franciscan approach that let us reconcile faith and science. And it gives us a framework where we could put knowledge, all kind of knowledge of nature, into one type of understanding. And I also want to draw attention to Pope Francis and his encyclical Laudato Si. And he emphasizes there can be no ecology without anthropology. You cannot make sense of how to protect the environment unless you understand how to protect human nature, human well-being, and all of that. For me, that was the central line in Laudato Si: no ecology without anthropology, and also no anthropology without ecology. So the questions for faith and science, what do we have to talk about here? So in my opinion, in the field of faith and science, we can just presuppose that faith and science are not in conflict. Anybody who has studied the question with any sense of honesty and attentiveness to facts will agree that faith and science are not in conflict. And when there's the appearance of it, there's usually some misunderstanding or misinterpretation. So we presuppose that faith and science are credible because it's not really under debate. But so instead of doing apologetics, instead of really trying to make draw a line from science to Christianity, we should really be talking about the difference between someone and something. Someone, like a human person, or something which is just a feature in nature. And an example some people will use as kind of analogous to a living being is what you have like a storm, an eddy in the water, or even the great red eye of Jupiter. When you have something which is somewhat stable in nature, a feature in nature, that has its own unity, it's a thing, definitely, but a human person or a living being in general, any living being, is not just a something, it's a someone, it's an object of its own, it has some inner organizing principle, it has a soul, is the easiest way of saying it. It organizes itself from the inside out. Some things organize themselves from the outside in, like a storm is being formed by the flow of air, and creates the, in case of an eddy, the water, and flowing past a rock. So a feature has no identity, but a someone is something very concrete, very specific. And the next question, human acting. Can we really understand human acting as integrated in scientifically understood nature? Or are we thinking of human acting like people used to think of miracles, breaking the laws of nature, kind of acting over and beyond the laws of nature, but not really respecting the beautiful and convincing order that physics has discovered. So we realize that really human acting and life are the questions that are so hard to capture in a scientific view of nature when we start with science. So the real question of the faith and science conflict or dialogue is not whether God fits into a scientifically understood universe, or whether God is the creator of a scientifically understood universe. Most people will find a way to agree to that. The real question, the real challenge is, does the human person fit into a scientifically understood world? Is the human person a natural being in a world understood by science. So we really have to take a look at what we even mean when we speak of nature. What exactly is nature? What is natural being? And I would like to tie it directly to human acting. I don't like to kind of separate human acting from nature too strongly. Human acting is in nature, but as we act, as we exercise our thoughts, our actions, our making our decisions, we do all of that in a context that is not of our making. Let's call that nature. Nature is simply the context in a reality that we capture. So nature, understood in this way, as context, as an environment, is not just a negative. It's not just human nature being opposed or human acting being opposed to nature. We can, of course, move beyond the laws of nature. We can build machines. We can build flying machines in order to allow us to fly like the birds. But then we use knowledge of nature in order to really act within nature to accomplish goals that nature without tools wouldn't give us. But we're still acting in nature, it's still natural. My favorite example for natural acting with tools is a carving knife. Like if you have a feast, a Thanksgiving feast, and if you have like a big family invitation and you have this beautiful carving knife, all the technology that goes into the steel that makes the carving knife so very sharp, and then you use this carving knife in order to slice the turkey and pass out portions to your family, to your friends, and celebrate. That's a very natural way of using the carving knife and a very natural way of consuming the turkey. But using the same carving knife in order to settle a family dispute that broke out while you had your family reunion, that is obviously a very unnatural use of this carving knife. There's really something in nature that we have to integrate when we make ethical decisions together with the decisions about how the use of technology. But then some will argue nature might not really be all that important because after all, do we even know that nature is real? Can we even say with any sense of certainty that there really is something out there, or is it just our thoughts? If you listened to Pater Anselm earlier today, then he also told the same, he raised the same philosophical question. And Pater Anselm and I, we have something in common. We are both, other than being friars, we are both fans of Robert Spemann, a German philosopher who is very influential in German philosophy. And Pater Anselm actually was a student, a graduate student of Robert Spemann. I only learned of his work much later. But Professor Spemann used to tell a story about how he kind of wakes up to reality. And it's a childhood story. When he was a little boy, Professor Spemann, he remembers a dream from that time. And this dream is that he was being chased in this dream by an evil sorcerer who was trying to do him bad. And as a little boy, he was scared. He was kind of having a nightmare. He was realizing something might happen to him. He was fearful. But then he remembered. His mother had told him, there are no sorcerers. There are no evil sorcerers. There's evil in the world, but there's no sorcerers. The world is rational. The world makes sense. So he remembered this in the dream. And he also remembered his mother had never said anything false to him. She had never lied. She had never misled him. He had full and complete trust in his mother. With this thought, he managed to shake off this dream, wake up from the nightmare, and realize he was at home in his bed in perfect safety. So it's a heartwarming story, you might say, of a child's trust in his mother. But the real story is the decision to take reality seriously is an act of trust. By trust, we wake up to reality, not by endless doubting, but by trust in something fundamental, in a trust in the comprehensibility of our being, of our life. And philosophy can provide some structure, but it cannot substitute the fundamental act of trust that is the foundation of making sense of reality and even saying yes to reality and studying it. And this is, of course, not the subject of the human sciences, and especially the sciences of nature. We have very good reason to have trust in science as knowledge of nature because it works so well. It gives us all these wonderful machines that we can use, including the slide projector. It gives us a deep level of understanding to cure diseases, to better our lives. So we have a good reason to have trust in science as knowledge of nature. But we also know that there must be more to nature than what science can see. And If you went to Karen Oebeck's talk, she mentioned that the progress in understanding the foundations of life has been very, very slow indeed. If you pick up a textbook on biology of the mind, typically, then you will usually find a line somewhere that they take it as a given that we have a natural physical understanding of the beginning of life. But when I was much younger, 40 years ago, I attended a conference with famous scientists who had been invited to meet young students. And many of those famous scientists were saying, the big discovery in your lifetime will be the understanding of the foundations of the origin of life. And now 40 years later, we are exactly at the same point, exactly the same theories, a lot of hand-waving, I suppose. Now, I don't necessarily doubt that there is a naturalistic understanding of the origin of life. But I have to draw attention to the fact that we are very far from understanding it. And most likely, we have not even grasped what it means to say this is a living being. And without having truly understood what we mean by the sentence, we may not be able to ever find the answer to it. So for me, the question of the origin of life is an open question. But the more important thing is, asking about life asks a question where physics and physical biology doesn't seem to have made any progress at all. And there's also consciousness. The whole question of consciousness is sometimes being explained as a natural process of evolution of language, of the origin of language coming out of animal signal functioning, and then eventually we develop the complex language of human being. But the real nature of language is something so more complicated, so more advanced, that the question, and without language, there's no real consciousness. There's consciousness in animals in the sense of recognizing an environment and stimuli, but the consciousness of I am and so are you and so is he, the first person, second person, third person consciousness, which makes sense of the world. I cannot see how something so fundamentally different from simply environment could emerge naturally. But at the same time, this is not now meant as an excuse to open the door to religious explanations. Of course, religion is important to us, but we are still asking simply about secular language of nature, secular knowledge of nature that exceeds scientific knowledge of nature, without actually making the step into religion just yet. Secular knowledge of nature must be broader than scientific knowledge of nature. And we must be attentive to this because science separates nature from human concerns. When we do a scientifically understood world, then there's no value left, no concerns left. It is all simply a factual description of the world, and our concerns now have nothing to do with nature any longer. Now, a term often used in order to speak of nature and the human language of nature is to speak of the book of nature. The book of nature is a phrase, I'm not sure who used it first, but Galileo used it very early on in a letter to a friend of his, where he wrote that the book of nature is written in the language of mathematics. He meant it as the book of the Gospels, the book of Revelation, and the other revelation to him was the book of nature. And he was right about that, but he was not quite right by saying that the entire book of nature is written in language of mathematics. And we must be very attentive to physical science and take it very seriously, because the physical description of the world works much too well to permit us to say it might be false or of the temporary structure that might be replaced by something else. The physics, to me, has to be true in all its aspects, evolution, evolutionary biology. All of that, to me, is as true as it can be known by human knowledge. But it evidently cannot be the real thing. It cannot be actually what we're talking about when we speak of nature in the broad sense. And the classical example, the very strong examples for why science and science of nature based on physics cannot truly describe what we care about the most come from modern physics. Everybody, I think, has heard of the example of Schrödinger's cat. And Schrödinger's cat is a classical example as to how you can couple a living being to a quantum superposition. A quantum superposition is something where a system is in two states at the same time until it's observed. And Schrödinger recognized right away the problem with that. If those quantum superpositions are real, he said, then the difference between life and death suddenly doesn't make any sense any longer. Because a being cannot be alive or dead. When it's dead, it no longer is. It is a being and non-being is the difference between life and death. So a superposition, like in quantum mechanics, is simply not compatible with the living being. But today, since about a few years, has been a lot of progress in the understanding of quantum mechanics, and the Nobel Prize last year went to researchers who have shown that these quantum superpositions are real. They're a real part of the world. So Schrödinger's question was firstly, is it even real? That has been answered. Yes, they are real. At the same time, living being cannot be in this state. So the simple conclusion is that what we mean by the word living being, the kind of being that there is, what exists, is not part of what physics describes. Physics describes material context of living being, but living being itself is simply not physics. Nor should it be. The whole question of physics excludes living being and excludes life. So not being able to understand it is no surprise if physics from the outset says we don't care about living being. The second argument comes from relativity. A living being is being in time. Each of us is the moment of now. Our being is passing in time. We are present now, but not in the past and not yet in the future. But this moment of now is missing from modern physics, from the physics of cosmology. In relativity, now is dependent on where you are and what the gravitational environment is. In physics, my finger and my foot are not in the same moment of now because they're spatially separated. It doesn't cause any contradictions in the mechanism of physics because the causal order is not changed by this. But the moment of now that is essential for my being real is lost in physics. So here's my second argument, that living being is simply not part of the language of nature in as much as science cares about it. And nor should it. It was excluded from the very beginning. It's not a criticism of science. Science is true. But it excludes the entire book of nature written in the concrete language of life. All of that is a separate understanding of nature, broadly understood, a whole book of revelatory knowledge written in the language of life that allows us to make sense of nature from the position of a living being. And as science has so detached itself from understanding life to the point that it no longer even thinks about it and doesn't even notice that it's no longer thinking about what is life, we have entirely separated ourselves from the ethical language of natural humanity. By being forgetful of life, we also become forgetful of ethics. The pro-life position is essential in order to truly make ethical sense and to take good ethical decisions in any aspect of life. For Robert Spemann, the quintessential example how we can go from experience of a living being, a conscious living being, now a human person, to understanding nature and right and wrong in nature and ethical thought is a simple experience of pain. When you are in pain, you know right away that you ought not to be in pain. It's not merely unpleasant, not merely a signal to stay away from a dangerous object, but pain is also a state of understanding that shows you something isn't right, something is wrong. Not simply painful. You can actually endure pain if you understand the pain. You can accept the pain and live with it if this is what you have to do. But the knowledge of pain tells you there's something in nature, in my natural being, that warns me that not all can simply be just factual, but there's right and wrong in nature. And of course, there's also very simple examples you can think of. Like another example is if you see yourself in a house, in an apartment high up in the sky, and you see a child at an open window crawling like a little toddler who doesn't know yet what he's doing, and you see him crawling up on the windowsill looking out of the window. The first thing you do is you go very slowly to not scare him, and you pick him up and you put him back on the floor. It is a natural human instinct to do. It is natural for us to protect our children. You might now argue, well, it's evolution. this ethical language of nature that I'm now reading here, that's just evolutionary biology. That's just our adaptation, our protection of genes. But I could say the same thing about stumbling. When I walk downstairs, I have reflexes that keep me from stumbling. That doesn't mean that gravity isn't real. I'm evolutionarily adapted to gravity by having reflexes keeping me from stumbling. And I'm also evolutionarily adapted to the ethical knowledge that we as persons, as thinking, as understanding human beings, discover in reading the book of nature. The ethical adaptation to the evolutionary adaptation in ethical acting is now understood as goodness, as being procreation, as being in favor of the environment, of reading what God has written into this book of nature. Properly understanding the human, the ethical language of nature really allows us to be fully human, to act in such a way that we fulfill our human nature to its best. Now, a book must have characters. A book must have characters in order to be interesting and to be exciting. So the characters in the book of nature, they're firstly human beings. And when we say, you are a human being, you are my brother, you are my sister, we are not merely acknowledging a biological fact. We are also making an ethical commitment. We are saying, this is one being, one creature, a human being, with rights, with duties, with obligations, a whole package comes there. The decision to recognize an actor in the book of nature is an ethical decision, not just a factual decision. And indeed, if you return to the image of a child's mental development, as a child makes sense of the world, first it's all just sounds and colors and shapes without any ability to make sense of it all. But eventually, one of those shapes or two of those shapes are becoming recognizable to the child as faces, as another person, a human being, mother, father, caregiver, brother, sister, anybody who's taken care of the child becomes the first objects, the first subjects, but the child doesn't know that yet, of concrete being in the world. And all our language, all our further mental development always goes from that starting point, human being as being the starting point, to really identify what is one being in the world, what is one actor in the world who acts. And as we make further sense of the world in this way, then we realize that there are living beings in the world, beings that are when they're alive and are not when they're no longer alive. A dog, a family pet that dies and leaves the body behind, is still materially there. But the dog as a living being, a child will realize right away, no longer is. The dog is gone. The body is left behind. So we have this real awareness that amongst the actors in the book of nature are living beings that are in matter, but not the same as the material identity. And we speak of them as part of the real beings of the world. Not the quarks and leptons of physics are the real beings in the world. The real beings in the world are living beings, human person most importantly. So what are the quarks and leptons? They're mostly, firstly, part of physical explanations of the world, but they really describe the substrate, the whole canvas of creation, the whole cosmos. Cosmologists are theoretical physicists who grasp the whole universe in its beauty and structure as one being, the cosmos, as one canvas on which God has drawn all of creation. And within this creation, within this material being, which is one grand cosmos, we have the distinct actors of living beings, with one class of living beings being able to not only see being, but also read the ethical language of the book of nature, to know the goodness of being, the goodness of care, and the goodness of sustaining it. We understand what it means to be an ethical being, to be a human being, to be a natural being, once we grasp that science cannot be first. Our most trusted knowledge cannot be science. Our most trusted knowledge are the human relationships that bring us into being. And from there on, we can develop trust in other knowledge, including scientific knowledge. We must always remember, when we speak of knowledge of science, it comes secondary to what we learned first. that our being is real, important, ethically significant, and deeply, deeply cared for and loved. Now, if this is all so simple, you might wonder, why is anybody in need of being convinced? A personalist view of nature, a human-centered view of nature, always runs into the challenge of explaining why human beings can be so defective in many ways. Most importantly, our ethical failings. Humanity has something that no animal has. It is human, it is humanly possible to be inhuman. The inhumanity of humanity is the great mystery. The ability to act against our nature, to go act against the ethical understanding of nature. No animal acts against this nature. A dog cannot be undoggy. A dog will always be its nature. Any animal is its nature and nothing else. But human beings have to concretely embrace the nature and live accordingly. We have to actually love our own nature in order to act according to our nature. We have to be human to be human, and we have to become human. So our potential for inhumanity is really what sets the human person apart in the understanding of what humanity truly is. And human violence is not animal violence. Animal violence, evolution, has something to do with the way we are violent, the way we may express anger when challenged, status fights in organizations, all of that. That has a link to evolution. But the core nature of human violence is something entirely different. And we read it right at the beginning after the fall in the book of Genesis, the murder of Abel by Cain. Cain murders Abel not because they're struggling over resources. It's not a sibling rivalry about attention to the biological father. Cain murders because he is angry, because he's envious of the recognition that Abel has received. Nothing else is missing for Cain. We do not know why he wasn't recognized, but the significance here is that Cain's act, murdering his brother, is the quintessential example for human violence as acting against nature, against his being, made possible only in the state of fall. But if you stick with secular knowledge, I wanted to stay with secular knowledge as long as I can, then if you really take the inhumanity of humanity seriously, then you really realize that the human person is absurd. We are called to ethical behavior, but we act unethically. We are called to community, but we act selfishly. And we say it's both natural. It's really, we would be absurd beings in an absurd creation. The real question you now have here is, do I turn to nature and God, or do I give up entirely? And if you give up entirely, then human life is meaningless, nature is meaningless, and you can simply try to meet your own needs as much as possible for as long as possible. And if you take this route of a strictly atheistic way of looking at nature, of not recognizing the absurdity of humanity as being reconcilable by faith, then indeed, nature looks to you as nothing but rat in tooth and claw. Then indeed, evolution is just violence, just trying to destroy what's already there. Then you can no longer see the ethical language that God has written into the law, into the book of nature. But if you realize there's a problem in human nature, yes, but there's still fundamentally goodness in nature, and the absurdity question of human nature can possibly be answered differently if you're open to reconciliation with God, if you're open to the possibility of healing after the fall, then you can see that nature indeed is good, and that indeed we can also be healed in this relationship. And now finally, I can tell you what Francis has to do with all this, the founder of my order. Without knowing that Francis understood human nature to be reconciled with God in Christ, in the incarnation, in the bodily presence of God, not in philosophical proofs of God's existence, not in theoretical physics, but the reconciliation in the knowledge that human nature was reconciled with God through the life of Christ, through his death, through his resurrection. And this basic embodied and fleshed material reality of Christian faith, in this relationship, he understood that really there was understanding possible for us, reading the language of nature and living with nature in a truly human way. Francis, as a nature mystic, makes no sense at all if you divorce Francis from its Christian foundations. That seemed to have happened at some point in the 60s, 70s possibly, that Francis became kind of a modern nature lover in an almost Buddhist sense. And he certainly wasn't. Francis was a very strict, fundamental Christian, Catholic, deeply obedient to the church and deeply trusting in his faith, in his relationship with Christ. This was first. He could be a lover of nature, a lover, a mystic of nature, somebody who could really read the book of nature only after having known how much he was loved by God, how much he was loved by Christ, and how much this relationship meant to him. The language of life, when read without Christ, becomes something which is the unbearable blandness of the lyrics of A Circle of Life. And I'm not sure whether you know the, I guess there's a Disney movie about this, but the circle of life that goes on and on and on. As a human being, you realize it is so fundamentally bland to have a story that goes in endless circles and never goes anywhere. Our human nature wants stories to go from a beginning to an end, and only very little children want to hear the same story over and over again without repetition. So the real story of nature is a much more interesting story that we can understand by seeing our own lives, our own human lives, to be part of the life of Christ, continuing as his resurrected body, continuing as the church, continuing and understanding even more deeply for us personally, individually, and as a community, what it means to be followers of Christ, to walk into his footsteps, and to learn how to properly read the book of nature in all its languages. With Christian faith, in the sense of St. Francis, naturalism, understanding nature, and acting in accordance with understanding nature is no longer imitating nature blindly without understanding it, but acting creatively in nature, acting in such a way that nature's creativity continues and our creativity and is enhanced ever further. You will probably know that we cannot simply turn to God, turn to Christ, simply by an act of will. I'm sure all of you have friends, people you deeply care about, maybe family members, maybe children, adult children, who have turned away from the faith. It's a story I hear over and over again in ministry. And I'm being asked, what can I do in order for people to turn back to the faith and recognize that God is with them? Well, the honest answer is, there's nothing you can do. You cannot put yourself in charge of your loved one's conversion. Only the Holy Spirit is in charge of conversion. And if somebody doesn't find his way to faith, then it's not for us to judge why that is the case. We can try to open their hearts. We can soften their hearts a little bit possibly, but ultimately they will not turn to faith until the Holy Spirit calls them and leads them that way. But what we can do is live our life as a Christian in such a way that makes it attractive to another to be open to the working of the Holy Spirit and to be open to the possibility or the certainty even that God loves them too and desires them too for his kingdom. And to learn how to act with this charity, with this understanding that makes conversion possible, Francis looked at fraternal life. In the Franciscan tradition, the real superior, according to St. Francis, is the Holy Spirit. But in practical life, in decision making, the fraternity is the superior. We have a guardian, we have a provincial, and they have a lot of responsibility and we have to respect them. But fundamentally, we have to look at the community to shape us. My Franciscan life, in practical reality, is not lived as independently as I would if I were a scholar at a university, but I live in community and have to deal with all these difficulties and problems that come with that. and I have to adapt to them, and they have to adapt a little bit to me as well. But mostly, you have to let yourself as a Franciscan be shaped by fraternity and learn how to live together with people who can be very difficult. Back in the day when we didn't have internet and Wi-Fi, the example was, imagine living in a house with 10 men and one remote control. So you have to make these little decisions, and you have to learn how difficult it can be to live with other people. But if you do, if you learn to be a little bit softer with your brothers and sisters, a little bit more open to really understanding how the Holy Spirit works in each and every one of us, then you can indeed learn to become better at leading people to openness to the Holy Spirit and conversion to Christ. And we learn what it's really all about in community. We learn again what every child knows. A child knows its being is dependent on care. It could not be without loving care. As adults, we tend to become independent, or maybe interdependent, but we are extremely difficult in accepting that we need care again. I notice it every day with my elderly brothers who become dependent on care. They cannot stand the fact that they become dependent on care, because our adult nature emphasizes so very much the importance of being independent and being strong for others, but not depend on, not weak, so that others can be strong. But the essence of Christian being, Christian life, properly understood, is to also be weak, to be able to accept to be in need of help, to be able to accept that others are strong and can help us. A child accepts that happily, adults do not. When Jesus says, be like children, that's what he means. Learn again to know that you are dependent, loved, and trusted and cared for by God. And in this way, in knowing what human nature really is meant to be about, what human nature is at its deepest foundation, we can then also understand how in a world that has fallen, that is in need of healing, we can act in such a way that we also are healed in reaching out to those who need our help. We can find meaning in human suffering. We can find meaning in disability as a weakness, in sickness as a need to be cared for. We can consider care for another as not an ethical obligation, but as something enhancing the meaning, the goodness of our own being. It is good to be cared for, it is good to care, and it's also good to be someone who permits another to be cared for. It is not only individual happiness, but the meaning of one's life. And the meaning of one's life is enhanced by allowing another to care for one or to care for another one. But these networks of care are so essential for our understanding of human nature, of human being, that without experiencing it daily in fraternal life, we cannot truly turn to the environment and understand our fraternity as with creatures in the same sense of our care reaching into nature. And natural rights can now be understood. We truly learn to understand human rights in being these ethical actors. We understand the human right of an embryo as being someone who is cared for, who is meant to be cared for, and whose life has meaning by being dependent on care, where the mother's meaning in life is in the caring for this embryo. And for as long as both are physically capable to do so, then the meaning is to be together until birth, and then the meaning of a newborn life is to be cared for. This fundamental meaning is a human right, which is why for Catholics, the question of the sanctity of human life after conception is a human rights question. We care for the human right of the human being which is present, which is a biological living being, not a mind. It may never be a mind, we don't know. But in this moment, it's a living being, is an ethical actor with a true meaning and the right to have this meaning come to completion and to growth. And the same goes for every animal. There's nothing wrong with consuming an animal. Animals live in the circle of life logic of biological life without human ethics. They know that it is that part of being, that food for another is part of the nature of an animal. It is part of their being, part of their meaning. Taking them as nourishment does not abolish their meaning. But taking that animal and torturing it in some way to maximize its utility in an economic system based on the value that it has as a resale object, that destroys the meaning, that entirely destroys the meaning of a living being, and therefore violates a right. It is wrong. It is not wrong to eat meat, but it is wrong to treat animals unethically until they become food on our table. We can understand how it is wrong to destroy the beauty of nature solely for economic gain. There's nothing wrong with economic gain, but there's no real competition between the two, because economic activity for human being is also seeking to enhance one's own meaning. Work, labor is meaningful for human beings, and our acting in the environment would destroy the meaning of our own lives if we were to destroy beauty of nature where it can be preserved and ought to be preserved. So once we properly read the book of nature comprehensively in a proper Christian understanding, we can recognize that the question of natural rights, human rights, animal rights, environmental rights, is not a competition of balancing contradictory demands. It is a harmoniously written book of nature that if only we properly read, we can act according to God's will in it. And this takes me to my last slide. And I mentioned at the very beginning the remark by Pope Francis, there can be no ecology without anthropology, and I added to that, no anthropology without ecology. Where the faith and science project matters the most is not in Christian apologetics, important as it is. For the society at large, outside of our church, where it matters the most is that we truly learn how to reconcile ecology and anthropology. And I hope I've shown you how we cannot do so unless we truly understand the human being, the human person, as the image of God in creation, reconciled with God in Jesus Christ. We cannot simply separate our Christian understanding from this, but the value of the Christian view and the Christian ability to speak of faith and science together is mostly in giving secular insights into how to really reconcile human being and the ecology in general. We can talk about the rights of creatures in a mature language that is not simply anthropomorphizing animals by giving them feelings and identities that they do not have. An animal is not a person. An animal doesn't have a right to live like a human being has a right to live. It is not life that is sacred, but it is being that is meaningful. We can truly speak of environmental stewardship. We can really speak of environmental stewardship in such a way that we speak of nature in a way of having understood how nature works, what we need, what nature needs. Think of the conflict that we recently had, the COVID vaccine, for example. For me as a scientist, it was a beautiful discovery, a great cause of joy for me. I was one of the first to receive the vaccine. I was grateful for it. I participated in research many, many years ago that indirectly ended up being part of that. But I also understand for a great many individuals, there's fear attached to this. There's fear attached to power lines, to cell phones. There's fear attached to technology that we do not understand. There's simply a natural human fear to not getting what we're doing when we're so dependent on technology, which is so far removed from nature. Integrating technology into a view of nature that is truly Christian, truly human, is one of the ways the Faith and Science Project can contribute to the propagation of Christian faith, the salvation of humanity, but also very practical to a more civilized political discourse. So environmental stewardship is really about the good life. It's about the good human life, the fulfillment of our meaning, and not a question of making compromises between quality of life and what the environment might need for us. This concludes my presentation. I thank you for your attention. Thank you.